There, but we got everybody's picture in their seat this morning. And that way, when we preach this morning, we are preaching to our congregation. So praise the Lord. God is so good, and we just want His presence to be felt here. So let's pray. Father, we just thank You and praise You, Lord. We offer up, Lord God, a thanks, an offering of thanks, Lord. Because You're good. And in all of this, Lord God, we know that there are so many people, Lord God, in the United States that had the COVID, Lord. And this flu, Lord God, has got people going real bad, Lord God. They're sick. And I just ask, Lord, that You'll touch their bodies, heal them. But there's a lot more going on. The suicides, the depression, the oppression. The ones, Lord God, that have mental health problems. Lord, sin has brought us to this place. And I just pray, Lord God, that the first thing that we would think about is please get rid of our sin. You died on the cross, Lord, so this would happen. And so we pray, Lord God, that we would believe that what You died for, You accomplished. We don't have to worry about this anymore, Lord. We can be washed in the blood of the Lamb. We can be cleansed as white as snow. And all the stuff, Lord God, can be behind us. So help us this morning, Lord God, to worship. Bless my family as they're helping me this morning. And bless all the ones that are listening. May we gather very soon, Lord God, to worship one more time, Lord. Let us not take it for granted when we do. Thank You, Jesus. May You be glorified. May You be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm caught up in Your presence. I just want to sit here at Your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. No, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, You don't owe me any. More than anything that You can do, I just want You. I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to You. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that You're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to You.
I'm caught up in Your presence, and I just wanna sit here at Your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, You don't owe me anything. And more than anything that You can do, just want you. And I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I just want you. Nothing else.
Sing it.
Nothing else. Nothing else. I just want you. I just want you. And nothing else. Nothing else. Nothing else will do. You know I just want you. Oh, nothing else. Nothing else. Nothing else will do.
Oh, I just want you. We want nothing but Jesus. You know, this virus is really tearing America down, maybe we're starting to get serious about one thing, and that's our relationship with Jesus. There is nothing more prepared that we can do than to get on our knees and ask the Lord Jesus Christ to forgive our sins and to forgive the sins of this nation. Because we're in trouble, and we need him. This is the gospel. I hope we believe it.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe. We believe. In this broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, we believe. We believe.
We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back. He's coming back again.
So let the lost be found and the dead be raised in the here and now. Let love invade. Let the church live aloud, and our God will say, we believe. We believe, and the gates of hell will not prevail, for the power of God has torn the veil. Now we know your love will never fail. We believe, we believe.
Here we go, sing it.
We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. He's coming back again.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. For Thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted far above all gods. For Thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted far above all gods. And I exalt Thee, I exalt Thee, I exalt Thee, O Lord, I exalt Thee, I exalt Thee.
I exalt Thee. weak and wounded sinner, lost and left to die. Oh, raise your head, for love is passing by. And come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. Then like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. And remember, when you walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, just fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely, it's steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, just cry to Jesus and live. And when the love spills over, music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus and live. And with your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye, and go in peace and laugh on glory's side. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus. Jesus, we'll fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live.
Thank you, Jesus. During this time when it seems like everything is coming against us, you need to know that when this really strikes and all the suffering hits us, God is still for us. And if God is for us, then really who can be against us? They can say whatever evil against you. They can pick on you. They can persecute you. But there is a joy that stirs up from the heart, from deep within the heart, that'll allow the Holy Spirit to come out of you and do something that is extreme. And I mean extreme. God wants to do something so powerfully in our lives all the time if we'll just open up. And the first thing I recommend, three main things. The first thing is that we repent. We repent. The second thing is that we give our lives upon repentance to a person that can guide them and direct them, and that is Jesus Christ, all the way. The third thing is to be obedient. Once our lives belong to Jesus, then we need to be obedient to the Lord. That's the hard thing for a lot of people. They can be obedient for one day. Actually, we can't. We think we can, but when we get to heaven, we'll find out we probably weren't. So once we know Jesus and we abide in Jesus, that he destroys sin, and he absolutely loves to destroy sin. That's his job on the cross, is to destroy sin. Draw me near. Draw me near. Draw me near. And I'll run after you. Come on. Yes, draw me near. Draw. After Jesus,
after you,
and I'll run,
and I'll run after you.
Flowing deep and flowing clean,
so that all can come and drink. But I know that you're right there, willing to prepare this open heart of mine to carry on to the place where I can be your servant and be your friend, one that you can depend on. Thank you, Jesus, for the grace that you have given us. We could never repay, but from our hearts we'd like to say that I thank you.
Praise the Lord. God bless all of you. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. And so thank you guys. We have to end. Praise the Lord. I have to honestly say that it's good to see everybody's faces. Because that's what I have here today, is everybody's faces. And I feel like walking up to one of them who's the new guy up here and introduce himself. What's your name? Are you shy or what? Yep, he's shy. We always introduce new people, so there, now you have it. So welcome to the altar this morning. And I'd like to say that even though the COVID virus has got a lot of people down, I refuse to get down. I got a stirring in my gut about things that are happening. I'd also like to say that from day one, when I came back from the session, I said something. I said that this is a test of America. And we know that something is wrong. We know that we are being tested with something. But here's what I do know for an absolute fact, okay? In my spirit, I know for a fact with me, and that is, I believe that we are at the beginning of the end. I believe that like I never have before, that what I see coming in the future is a pandemic that will make this look weak. And I don't say that to scare anybody. I just know that when you start talking about viruses like this, you start talking about vaccinations that have trackers in them, you start talking about what the WHO is talking about, then to me, that is scary. It completely infringes on the rights of Americans and on the rights of Christians. And I think that people are seeing it now. They're getting tired of it. I wish that people would open their eyes and see and use common sense on what to do with this. In our own hospitals, we visited the hospitals and Panhandle Health last week, the legislators. We found out that our hospitals are losing $12 million a month in the loss of this. Well, they can't go long doing this before now we have to pay for the hospital somehow to keep them open. And so if we don't have any hospitals, then we can't have surgeries and we can't help the other people. And at the same time, the hospital last week had to not lay off, but they kind of gave, I forget the word for it, but a leave of absence to 221 people. Because our own hospital basically hardly has anybody in it. Our surgeons are sitting by the side just waiting for people like you and I to be able to have surgery today. And this is because of the COVID. And yet at the same time, the COVID has yet to even enter into our hospital. And we probably won't until we start to interact with each other and things start to happen to where the second part of the camel's back the little hump comes in and we realize that other people are going to get it and other people are going to have to get it and come out of it. But I want this congregation to look up, and I want you to have a joy in your hearts. I want you to have strength that only comes from Jesus Christ. I want you to know that God is alive and well, and he's doing something. We will continue very soon, and I am praying for the first Sunday in May to be back with all of you. And that's what I'm really praying for. And I'm also praying to get our testimonies back up and running so you know that God is still alive and well. Last Tuesday morning, I woke up from a dream. And in that dream, I had a man that was red-faced, and boy, he was preaching. His veins were kind of like sticking out of his neck, and I even remember part of the subject. And I didn't really think a lot about it, but for anybody that knows me, I don't dream very often. When I do dream, I try to pay attention to why. And during the week, I met with this man, and we started talking, and I knew at that particular point that he was supposed to take the pulpit this morning. And so I would like to really, really admonish a man for obeying the Lord. And we have something else here. Yes, son.
Danny says to remember to remind people to text the altar.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Let me see. For everybody to get on the new altar message site, all you have to do is by typing the word altar, to remember to remind the people to opt it to text messaging, by typing the word altar to 97000. So, can you explain what that means?
I'm not totally positive either. So I think you're going to get messages from the church, like notifications, and to opt into this messaging group, you text 97000, and you text the word all lowercase altar, A-L-T-A-R. Thanks.
We're probably wrong in something, but you'll figure it out, okay? You'll get a message, type in 97000, and at this time, I'm going to pray, and I'm going to have our brother Tim Scott, and he's going to come this morning, and he has a message for everybody. So I ask in Jesus' name that the anointing of your Holy Spirit, Father, would just be right here, right now. I pray, Lord, that you will guide and direct us in a way, Lord God, that is absolutely supernatural. I've been praying that for a long time, and I pray it this morning. I ask, Lord, that whatever we lack, Lord God, in our abilities, the Holy Spirit would give it to us this morning. Bless him to bless us, and may there be a message of an alertness, a wake-up call to America. And we thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Brother Tim.
Thank you. Well, praise the Lord. Amen? Amen. You know, I was as I was listening to the worship and participating in the worship, I remembered when I got saved on February 5th of 1987 in Elbert's Cabins number 2 in Glendive, Montana, 59330. And I remember how wonderful it was. At that time, I had 2 legs, 2 arms, 2 hands, and 2 feet. But I remember going outside of the room after I had repented and received Christ's sacrifice, and I remember how crisp and clear the air was and how wonderful the presence of the Holy Spirit was. And, you know, I want to encourage everybody that's listening today to let God take you back. Like he said to the church of Ephesus, you have walked away from your first love. It's time that we get back to that first love, which is the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit before our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So I pray for you today that you will get back to that moment and back to that time, because it is absolutely precious. There's been times that I have gone through some difficult things. It's difficult at times to live with one arm and one leg every day. But I'll tell you what, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. God will not allow more to come upon me of that which I cannot handle. And so God knew ahead of time, even before it happened, that if I would put my trust in him, that I would be able to get through every challenge that I face every day. I remember having a conversation with a man one time, and he asked me a question. Or he made a statement. He said, "Tim, I don't know how you do it." And I said, "What do you mean?" He goes, "I don't know how you do it and people like you, how you maintain such a strong faith over so long period of time." And I remember looking at this man and I said, "You know how I do it?" I said, "I just don't let my head go places it doesn't belong. Because stinking thinking produces stinking results. And so as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. But if you keep your head in Christ and on Christ and your eyes on the right focus and the right person, which is Jesus, you will get through everything. It's not that it won't be a challenge, because life is a challenge in itself." I want to open this morning with Psalms 139:14. It says this, "I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well." We are currently living in a time that is fearfully and wonderfully made. These are times appointed by God. And though there may seem to be uncertainty, there is no uncertainty with God. If you set your mind on your heart on something that can be moved, you yourself will be moved. But if we set our minds and our heart upon the rock, upon Jesus, though the winds may come, the storms may come, and though the house may be shaken, we will not move, because we stand on the only sure and solid foundation that is to be found, and that foundation is found in Jesus Christ and in Him alone. In 1 Corinthians 2:9 through 16, it says, "But as it is written, eye has not seen nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God." Isn't that what Pastor Tim just said? Didn't he say that, you know, on the cross, Jesus finished, he said, "It is finished." And when he said it was finished, what he meant was all that needs to be obtained has been attained. All that needs to be done has been done. We need only to call upon the name of a living God, and he will make available to us by revelation all that we need to endure every single day. "These things we also speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But he who is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is rightly judged by no one. For who has known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ." Colossians 3:2 says, "Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth." It is important that we make sure that we have our head headed the right direction. Amen? We need to have our minds set upon Christ. I tell the men that I work with, and I've had such a privilege through Solid Ground Ministries to be able to minister to the men of the community, the men of this church and other churches. And the one thing that I always tell them is that we must have our minds set upon Christ and upon nothing else. That God's word, as a true believer, should become the native language of our life. Instead of sitting down and talking about football and basketball and what a great boat I have, and, well, we're going to go out and go hunting and we're going to do this, our conversation should be centered upon the Word of God, and it should flow from us like rivers of living water each and every day and in every conversation we have with each other. It should be set upon God. So before I get into the meat of the message, Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you. I thank you that, Jesus, you are established upon your throne, secure in your position, and that our Heavenly Father has given you the name that is above all names, in which every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. That, Lord, like I tell to the men that I have the privilege of working with, no one is getting away with anything. Because we can't hide our deeds from a God that knows everything. So I pray, Lord, for the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit, not only in this room now, but also in every household that is receiving this message. I pray for the conviction of the Holy Spirit to come upon everyone, because you did not come, Lord, to condemn men's lives, but you came to save them. You didn't come to destroy men's life, but you came to save them. And Jesus, just as you said to the disciples, the guys, I have to suffer. I have to go to a cross. I have to give my life. Because only in my going to my Father will he come. And that he is the Holy Spirit of God, the power of God, the dunamis of God, released in the world in people's lives, that they need only to tap into that, and they will have a life that will be radically changed for Jesus Christ for all eternity. So I pray, Holy Spirit, I ask you, as we gather together now here and through every home, two or more of us together, I pray for the moving and the power and the presence and the conviction and the revelation of Jesus Christ to be brought to us through the power and the presence of your Holy Spirit. I pray over everyone listening. Give them ears to hear and a heart to perceive, Lord. And Father, in the name of Jesus, I take authority over every spiritual force of darkness, that they will not hinder the receiving of this message. They will not steal the seed in the hearts, because I pray, Lord, for your Holy Spirit to prepare the hearts of everyone listening, that they would receive the power of your word and be transformed from this day forward, in Jesus' name. And you can say amen out there. Amen. Well, when I sat down and I talked to Pastor Tim, there's been one thing that has really been on my heart. The title of this message today is called, Ready Your Hearts, the King is Coming. The crux of the message will primarily be out of Matthew chapter 24. So if you have your Bibles, you have your iPhones, you have your smartphones, go ahead and go to the app. I'll be teaching out of the New King James Version. That's just kind of what I do. So if you have that, open it up and follow along. In Matthew chapter 24 and verse 1, it says, Then Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came up to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said to them, Do you not see all these things? I pray, church, that those words wrap themselves around your heart and fill your mind. And I pray that Jesus will continually ask you this question, Do you not see these things? It is so important. He said, Assuredly, I say to you, not one stone be left upon another that shall not be thrown down. Now we know that this occurred in 70 AD when the Romans, led by Titus, sacked Jerusalem and the temple was destroyed completely, leaving not even one stone upon another. But it goes on to say in verse 3 of Matthew chapter 24, Now as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, Tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? And Jesus answered and said to them, Take heed that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive many. Now the term take heed means to listen, to pay attention. There are other passages in Scripture that instruct us to be sober, to be vigilant. Proverbs 1:8 tells us, My son, hear, take heed to the instruction of your father. Proverbs 23:22 tells us, Listen, take heed to your father who begot you. 1 Peter reminds us, in chapter 1, starting to verse 3, Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope. I pray, Lord, that the people that hear this message would listen and see these things. Man was begotten according to the book of Genesis when God took man and he made him and formed him from the dirt of the ground. God loved man so much. He loved you, every person that is out there. Man and woman, he loved you so much that he took man and formed him from the dirt of the ground. He personally took that and did that with his hand, forming him. And man at that time, it says, without life, without form, and God breathed the breath of life into him, and he became a living being. That is when God first begot us. But now, according to Peter, for all that have received the sacrifice, for all that have repented in their lives, it says that he has begotten us again to a living hope. Why can I endure 30 years of living on one leg? Why can I fall down repeatedly and get right back up again? Because I don't live according to how I am. I live according to how he is. And he has given me a living hope that can rise above every challenge and give me life in that eternally. It says that he has gotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Why must we build our lives upon the solid rock? Because it doesn't fade. It doesn't weaken. It is the same yesterday, today, and will be forever. It is a solid rock that cannot be moved. And I recommend that everyone that is out there listening, that you pay attention to that. And you understand that God has given us an inheritance that is absolutely mind-blowing and incredible. And we need only to surrender and tap into it. And as Jesus would say, do you not see all these things? Philippians 3 in verse 10 through 14, it is written, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering. You know, so many of us, we want to know Jesus. We just don't want to know the suffering. We want to live a soft and cushioned life. And I think in America, we have. We've been a blessed nation. Our money says, in God we trust. Do we? We want all the good things. We want the nice house, the nice car. We want all the toys. But Lord, give it to me without suffering. But you know, I'm reminded of Jesus, and it says, and Jesus learned obedience by the things that he suffered. And we need to embrace the fact that, you know what? Suffering is just a part of the church. Just the same as if you're a golfer, your bad slice going off the fairway and into the woods is a part of your golf game. We need to accept and understand that there will be suffering from time to time. There will be joy time to time. There will be happiness from time to time. But it's all part of life. The fellowship of his suffering, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on, that I may lay hold of that which for Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended. But one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. If you set your mind or heart on something that can be moved, you yourself will be moved. But if you set your mind on Christ, you will not be moved. It won't be that you won't be challenged, because you most certainly will be that. But you will not be moved. Continuing on in 1 Peter in 1:6, it says, in this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials. See, that's what just happened to the church. Everybody was just kind of cruising along. Everything's nice. Maybe we're showing up for church. We're getting our latte and the coffee shop, and we're all coming together and we're visiting. Then all of a sudden, bam, we get hit with the COVID-19. And then the church is tested. And I believe I love the church and I love the pastors, but I want to tell you something. The church did not pass this test. The church failed. Because nowhere in the Word of God do I find that the church runs and isolates. We have a greater commission than that. And we should have stood up in the power of God and contested the orders that were given us, because they may have been the ordinance of man, but they were not the orders of God. I remember speaking in, I think it was in North Carolina, back in the mid to late 90s. And I'd ministered at a church, and when I got done with a message, people were coming up and talking to me, and one of this guy came up to me and he goes, "You know, Brother Tim," he says, "man, I'll bet you when you got hit by that train, I'll bet you that really brought you close to God." And I remember looking at him and I said, "You know what? I recommend that you're close to God before the train comes." And that's the problem with a lot of the church today. Are we really living out what we say we believe? Boy, we could preach a good message, can't we? Boy, we could talk a good message. But it's really seen in how we live. And it's important, church, pastors, anybody watching this message, that you start walking out what you say you really believe. That we need to stand up for the cause of Christ, because the world needs to see that we really believe what we say that we believe. In 1 Peter 1, 7 through 9, it goes on to say in verse 7, the reason that we go through these fiery tests and these various trials is that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire. And I would remind everybody that our God is a consuming fire. And it is a fearful thing to be in the hands of a living God. Why? Because God is preparing a bride, and He will by fire, He will by trials, He will by tests, make sure that bride is ready when the trumpet sounds and it is time to go to the banquet. That it may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen you love. I love that passage of Scripture, because it says that of me and of you, that we are even more blessed than the disciples were, even though they walked with Jesus, they touched Jesus, they saw Jesus. It says in Scripture that because I believe in Him, I am more blessed than even they that walked with Him, though I don't see Him. What a beautiful message. Though you do not see Him, yet believing you rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, that is, the salvation of your souls. I've long since believed, and I was taught early on as a young Christian when I got saved on February 5th of 1987, that your soul is comprised of your mind, your emotion, and your intellect. And God's goal is to make sure that we walk around in the right mind. God's goal is to make sure that we keep our emotions in check. And God's goal is to make sure that we have the right information in our brain. That way our soul prospers each and every day. Because like they're saying out there goes, you get garbage in, you're going to get garbage out. So it's important that we keep our head in the right place. In Hebrews 12, 1 through 3, it says, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Let us run with endurance. Why didn't the church endure this last test? Well, I have a funny feeling that there might be some weights and sins in people's lives that don't belong there. And when you have those things, it causes you to compromise. And Paul wrote to Timothy and said, and some, having violated their conscience, have shipwrecked their faith. That when we don't deal with our lives, when we don't deal with the sin in our lives. And I'll tell you what, the Apostle Paul wrote 13 letters to the New Testament, in the New Testament. And in every single letter, he deals with the church and the issue of sin for those who are believers. We need to deal with it. Jesus, in his public ministry, in Matthew chapter 4 and verse 17, it says, and from that day forward, he began to preach, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And my message to you partly this morning is, deal with your life. Take an examination of who you are. Be honest in your heart before God. If you need a brother to confess to, go to them. Confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. For the effectual fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. We need one another. And this last test of making the church non-essential was a bunch of baloney. I have never seen in my lifetime, I'm 62, I'll be 63, I have never seen in my lifetime where the church has been made non-essential and told to stay home. Like we can count on the government to take care of everything for us. No. See, the government only sees you as a two-part being. They only see you as a mind and a body, but the church sees you as a three-part being, knowing full well that the only hope you have in your life to be sound in body, sound in mind, and sound in spirit is through the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's why we are essential. That's why we should be open. And I pray that everyone out there will support this, encourage your pastors, and encourage other people and other churches to get up, get counted, and get open. When we do not deal with the sin and detraction outside of the will of God for our lives, we will become weak and we lack endurance. We become spiritually unfit. It goes on to say in verse 2, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. In other words, I remember Jesus praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. He said, hey, Father, if it's possible to remove this cup from me, yet not my will, but thy will be done. I know that in the flesh he struggled with the whole idea of getting beaten up, a crown of thorns on his head, having himself pierced by a sword, having himself beat by a whip that tore the flesh from his body, and then having himself nailed to a cross. He despised that. He wasn't looking for that, having to take on the sin of the world. But he understood the joy, and he understood the reward that was awaiting him. And church, we need to understand the same thing. We need to understand the reward that is waiting us. An eternity in paradise with Jesus Christ, taking communion with him again, anew in paradise, and being with him forever where there is no sin, there is no sickness, there is no depression, there is no anger, there is just the life of God pulsating through every living being. We need to remember those things. We need to stir up by way of remembrance like Peter told the church. He said, I will tell you and stir you by way of remembrance as long as I'm in this body. Because when I go, wolves will come in. People will come in. People will become complacent. So I stir up by way of remembrance and stir you, church, to get on board with God. He goes on to say in verse 3, for consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your soul. Why are the emotions going up and down? Why do we fear man? Why do we fear the opinion of the community? Well, because there's sin, there's things in our life we're not dealing with, and as a result of that, we have become weak and weary in our souls. Because we're watching too much CNN, MSNBC, and all the rest of them, Fox and all them, and all that is doom and gloom, and we're taking COVID in night and COVID in day. Our souls have become weak, and we have become weary. And it's time that we set those things aside and understand, you know what? This is just the way life is right now. These are the things that we will have to face. But I know that I will not do it alone because my God is with me. Matthew 4:4, Jesus speaking says, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. What does this mean? If you're living by the news of the day, the cares of life, the pursuit of riches and possessions, and the pressures from man, and not weighing the news, the cares, and the pressures through the word of God, you will be lost and confused. Fear will rule over you more than faith rising up in you. God wants us empowered and strong to withstand the onslaught of the world. He wants our souls preserved unto righteousness that is achieved with the right focus. That was out of Hebrews chapter 12, but if we remember chapter 11, it talks about all those who came before us. We are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. It's talking about Abraham and Isaac. It's talking about Moses. It's talking about all these wonderful men of faith who went through hell on earth to obtain the prize. But because they didn't waver, they now surround us. And I really believe they are cheering the church on in heaven. It's time that we respond. We must focus upward. So let's look at today through God's word. It's important that regardless of whether you read the paper, whether you watch the news, it's time to judge what's going on there through the lens of God's word. Matthew 24, we're going to pick up again in verse 6. And you will hear, this is where we're at, of wars and rumors of wars. And then Jesus says, see that you are not troubled. Well, if your focus is in the right place, if you understand that these things must happen, that's all part of God's plan, that it's all part of what must take place, you won't be troubled. But if you forget that, you will be troubled. For all these things, Jesus said, must come to pass. But the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. And there will be famines, pestilences, and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. The beginning of sorrows is a term to describe a woman just before birth. After conception, she experiences joy at the thought of being with child. She informs family and friends of the good news, and everyone celebrates. As time goes on, discomfort sets in as the child grows. She experiences lower back pain and smells that make her nauseous. The time of delivery approaches, the labor pains increase in both frequency and intensity, and just after the moment of the greatest pain, the child appears and her heart is filled with joy inexpressible. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled, for these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines, pestilence, and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Since Jesus is not here yet, it means, and brace yourself, the most intense is yet to come. Man, if we can't handle the little battles, how will we ever handle the big battle? It talks about that before Christ's return, and even Paul said that a falling away must occur. Why does that falling away happen? Well, because their mind is on the wrong things. They're more concerned about what their neighbor thinks instead of what God thinks. We need to be concerned about what our Heavenly Father thinks. And it is He that I want to please. Jesus even said, I am about my Father's business. And you know what? It's time that we understand our Father's business. And it's time that we get up off the couch and out of the homes and from behind the TVs and out of the boat, out of the car, and out of the UTVs and off the mountain and out of hunting and start get about doing the Father's business. And as I said before, that the beginning of sorrows is the increase of both intensity and frequency of these events. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. Famines, pestilence, and earthquakes in various places. In Idaho alone, we've had 204 earthquakes from September of 2019 to our present day. The CDC reports that there have been over 200 epidemics worldwide in the last year. Today, the world stands on the brink of unprecedented famines. About 30 million people are experiencing alarming hunger, several levels of food insecurity and malnutrition. 10 million people are facing emergency and famine conditions. And with nation rising against nation and conflicts in the world, there have been over 10,000 combat-related deaths in this current year. And yet the most intense is yet to come. And Jesus would say to you, do you not see all these things? And I would say, ready your hearts, because the King is coming. In John 16:33, Jesus will, speaking here, he says, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. I'm always fascinated by the word may, because I think may really designates a choice. You may have it, you may not have it. You may trust God if your head's in the Word, and if you're down and paying attention to the things of God, and you're searching out the heart of God, and you're giving your heart wholly and complete to them, then you may have peace. But if you aren't, then you may not have peace. We need to search out God. People, it is time. You know, I got to tell people, I tell the guys that I work with, I said, you know, back in the 40s and the 50s and even in the early 60s and 70s, I wasn't concerned too much about Christ returning right then. I didn't even care because I wasn't even a Christian until 1987. But back then, the one thing that was missing in all those times that wasn't present, that is present today. We've seen Israel become a nation. We have the proof of that on May 14th, 1948. We see them being gathered together in 1918 back to the land of Israel. We see the alliance between Gog and Persia, which is Russia and Iran. We see different things that are taking place where Scripture is being fulfilled. But back then, there was one thing that was not present. Because someday the Antichrist will rise up. And he will demand a mark. But in order to have a mark, he has to have the technology to enforce it. He has to have a way of being able to track and know where every living human being is at and whether they have that mark and whether they can buy or sell. Well, hey, guess what, church? It's here. The technology is here. Now, I don't know the hour and the time when the Lord will return, but I can tell you that all the signs are there. And the beginning of sorrows is going to be coming more and more intense. And now is not the time to play games. Now is the time to get on your face and truly serve a living God. It has nothing but your best interest in mind. It says here, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world, you will have tribulation. Well, now, wait a minute. I thought God just wanted me to be prosperous and have all kinds of money and cars and nice homes and wear nice clothes and have nice friends. No, Jesus didn't say that. He said, if you seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, that all these other things will be added unto you. And the one thing that will be added unto you will be peace. And through that peace, you'll be satisfied with what you have and you won't covet your neighbor's things. But he goes on to say here that you will have tribulation. What is tribulation? I mean, it's a word that we talk about an awful lot, the word that we speak about from time to time, but what does it really mean? Here's what words describe tribulation. Suffering, distress, trouble, misery, unhappiness, sadness, woe, grief, sorrow, pain, anguish, agony, difficulty, worry, anxiety, trial, adversity, tragedy, trauma, affliction, and setbacks. There's a lot of people out there right now that are feeling they're suffering a setback. A lot of business owners that are going, man, what are we going to do? Well, I'll tell you what you need to do. If you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you need just to trust Him. I'll tell you a little story. I remember when we had started Solid Ground Ministries, and I knew that God wanted us to go online. I knew that God wanted us to do testimonies so that we could get them out over the internet and be able to encourage people by the testimonies of others. But you know what I didn't know? I didn't understand how to do it. So as we visited various churches throughout town and everything, I would go up to the guys in the booth, and I would just talk to them, introduce myself, tell them who I am, tell them what I'm, and I'd say, hey, was there any way that maybe we could meet sometime? And just maybe you could help set me straight and kind of put me in the right direction to understanding these things? What ended up happening is I had a lot of people that just flattered me and patted me on the back, but nobody did a doggone thing. And I grew very frustrated to the point where it was almost coming into being a little begrudging towards individuals. But then one morning I got up. We had a board meeting scheduled for Wednesday. I got up on Tuesday morning, and I really wanted to have some answers for the board. And so I had my computer and my iPad and everything set up, and I'm just sitting there kind of grumbling, and all of a sudden the voice of the Lord comes into my heart, and he says, Tim, I can't do a doggone thing in you and to you if you don't get rid of this animosity. He said, if you don't forgive, I can't do anything for you, Tim. And I would remind you, Tim, that there's nothing new under the sun. The technology might be new to man, but it's not new to me. And as I sat there and everything, he just began to bring people's names, and I began to confess, Lord, I forgive, I forgive, I forgive, I forgive, I forgive, I forgive. Lord, forgive me. And within 30 minutes, I had made my first video. Why? Because I had cast off the weights and the sin that so easily entangled. Now I can run with endurance and do the things that God has called me to do, because I'm not all weighed down with the wrong things. I am filled up with the right thing, and that is the Holy Spirit in Jesus Christ. Jesus continues with, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. All that I just mentioned about tribulation Jesus suffered, it also says that he was tempted in every way a man, with yet without sin. So as he overcame, so can we, if we'll trust him, and we set your mind on things above. It is written in 1 John 5:4, for whatever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. And without faith, we can't please God. For when we come to him, when we call upon his name, Jesus, we must believe he is all we need. He is all we need. I remember talking to the guys during the sixth battle class. I love my wife. My wife, Pamela, is the most incredible woman. And I just wish that all men had a wife like mine. She's awesome. I'm not saying anybody else's wife isn't good either, but she's awesome. But I told the men there, I said, guys, you know what? I don't find my identity in my wife. I don't find my identity here. Jesus said that if you love brother and mother or sister more than me, then you're not worthy of me. I don't find my identity in my children. I don't find my identity in my friends. I don't find my identity in the things that I own. I have a nice 2012 Targa V18 21-foot boat with 150 horsepower outboard and a 9.9 horsepower kicker and a brand new Altera trolling motor on the front. It sits in my garage because I told the Lord, if you let me buy it, if you give me the green light, then I'll make sure it never takes precedent over you. So consequently, the boat doesn't really get used a whole lot. But what I did tell the guys is this. I find my identity in Christ. If I want to know who Tim is recreated to be, then I need to know the Creator that is making me into who I need to be. Because only in him can I then love my wife and be the covering for her. Only in him can I then be the example for my family. Only in him can I truly manage my life. Because when Paul sent Titus and Timothy into the region to appoint elders and deacons, the first qualification was that he must be a faithful man. God is calling out right now, you need to be a faithful man because God has a job for you. He has something he wants you to do. And you can be a faithful man if you put your trust in the Lord. He goes on to, we go on to say, to survive the troubles and tribulations of this world, you absolutely need to be born of God who has already overcome the world. And I say again, ready your hearts, for the king is coming. Coming. Sound like I'm from the south now. And if you are absolutely born of God, you need to narrow your focus on Jesus and remove the distractions that pull your attention from his word. I.e., what is the press going to say about me? What articles are they going to put in the paper? I'll tell you what, this is what irritated me about this whole shutdown. Is I was being told that I can trust Lowe's, Home Depot, Fred Meyer, Albertsons, Super One, Safeway, the auto parts store, and everyone else more than I can trust my pastor and my congregation. I'm sorry, people, but that's messed up and it's wrong. And the reason it was put in there was that they wanted to make the church ineffective because they wanted to see what our response would be. Well, it's time that we stand up and respond in accordance with God's word. Like I said, you will get out what you put in. A little time in the Word, in the presence of Jesus, produces little results. We must not have a divided attention. We must be close to God before the train comes. Proverbs 3:6 says, in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. Matthew 12:25 says, but Jesus knew their thoughts and said to them, Every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself will not stand. We need to be united. My wife and I are united, the two becoming one, united in Christ. We counsel with each other the decisions that need to be made to make sure that we're on the same page together so that we walk in the unity of the Spirit and in the gospel of peace. Because when you walk united, there is peace. When you walk divided, there is desolation. So I ask, are you divided? How can two walk together, at least they be in agreement? Do you live in agreement with God's word? That's the most important thing. I mean, you say you believe it, but is it seen in the fruit of your life? I mean, in church, do you speak so eloquently, and then when you get on the job, profanities fly? We need to make sure that we are living it out and walking it out in accordance with the word of God. Because people, I'll say it to you again, and hear me. No one is getting away with anything. The Apostle Paul is quoted in Acts 2, 26 and 27 as saying, "Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all men, for I have not shunned to declare to you the whole counsel of God." Are there other things that take preeminence in your life over other than the Lord? Is all that you do subject to the Lord's discretion, and are you acting on your own? Are you building faith in your life? Whose voice are you listening to, the voice of man or the voice of God? And who do you fear, God or man? When I first got saved in 87, I had a pastor by the name of Mike Linz. And the one thing that I always admired to him right from the get-go is Mike gave the whole counsel of God. Because Mike understood that if I don't preach the whole truth and nothing but the truth and all of God's word, be it whether it's comfortable or uncomfortable, convenient or inconvenient, but giving the word as it is, knowing that I change no one, that only the Holy Spirit does, and that my responsibility as a man of God is to plant seed and water seed, and it is God that brings about the growth. I admired that of him. That's what I give to my kids, that's what I give to the people around me, and that's what I give to the men around me. And I want to tell you something, people. If you will just do that, you will see incredible growth in people's lives. Live by the whole counsel of God's word. Don't throw this out because it's not convenient. Receive it all. That's what Paul did. And as a result of that, he says, "I have the blood of no man on my hands." We need to be able to answer these questions in our own heart. Peter and John stood up to the pressures of the governing authorities of their day because what was ordered was outside of the will of God. I'm all in favor of Romans 13:1, that we need to be obedient and subject to the authorities. But I'll tell you what, if you read the rest of the chapter of Romans chapter 13, it talks about they're there when people are doing evil. So I can tell some of the people to come out of the ranch. Don't go back into your old life. Because if you do, you're going to be outside of the will of God. You're going to be doing things that are evil. And God will use the authorities to jerk you up and get you in line. In Acts 4, 29 through 30, we see the story. "It's now, Lord," Peter talking, "look on their threats and grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word. By stretching out your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done through the name of your holy servant, Jesus." They were threatened with harm. They were told to shut down. They were told they couldn't talk about Jesus. Now, they didn't go back to the rest of the guys and go, "All right, guys, here's the way it is. We're just going to have to lock in, and we just can't say anything. We can't do anything. You know, these people are scary." We need to stop that. We need to fear only one but God. Because what can man do? Man can only destroy my body. Man might go ahead and try to destroy my reputation, but as long as I keep my right life right before God, the reputation that matters will be intact. Amen? We have a commission, church. First, from the Lord himself. Matthew 28, 18 to 20. "And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, here's the promise. I am with you always, even to the ends of the age. Man, you know, God was with a guy by the name of Antipas. Talks about in the book of Revelation, and I believe it's chapter 2, and he talks about my faithful servant Antipas. And for those of you that don't know much about Antipas, he was a real devout man of his times. And he was preaching the word, and they didn't like that. So they took Antipas, and they seized him, and they wanted to silence his voice, and they put him inside a brass bowl that had hollow chambers. And they would put people in a bowl like that, and they would light a big fire underneath them, and then the screams of those that were burning to death could be heard, and it would bring chills up everyone's spine, and it would cause those around him to step in line. You know what? I'll tell you what. I'm going to write bad things about you in the paper. So write them. You're not getting away with anything. Just as I will be held accountable for my actions, so will you. But Antipas, when they told Antipas, they said, Antipas, the whole world is against you. And Antipas' response was, then I am against the whole world. And when they lit that fire, instead of screaming in pain, he was heard, glorifying God and praying for the church. Like I told Pastor Tim the other day, I said, you know, when it comes down to the trials and the tests, and it comes down to the possibility of persecution in America, God's grace will be sufficient, and he will empower us to handle every challenge that we face. Man, when I got hit by that train on March 24th of 90, I didn't feel any pain. It just knocked me down, took off my arm and leg, and when I rolled over on my back, I said, Lord, I am not afraid to die. Why? Because death has been swallowed up in victory. I'm born again. I trust Jesus. And I said, Lord, I know that heaven's got more than this world could ever offer. And I said, but Lord, now I'm making my request. I said, Lord, I got a wife I don't hardly know. At that time, Pam and I had only been married for 3 months. And I said, and a baby I've never met. Michael was in her belly. And I said, but Lord, I want your will, not my will, to be done. And God's will was for me to live. And as a result of that, I overcame and have overcome to this day. Why? Because I want his will to be done in my life. And the church needs to get to that point where suffering is a part of life. Suffering is used by God to test the genuineness of our faith. But if we'll keep our eyes intently focused upon the author and the perfecter, the finisher, the King of glory, the Lord of lords, the great I am, the wonderful counselor, Jesus Christ himself, if we will keep our eyes upon him, all the rest of us, all the rest of those things will melt off us like snow in the heat. And we will rise above and give glory even in the midst of challenge and turmoil. And if you are absolutely born of God, you need to narrow your focus on Jesus and remove the distraction that pulls your attention. I hate it when I do this. Now, the Apostle Paul. Therefore, I attest to you that this day I am innocent of the blood of all men, for I have not shunned to declare the whole counsel of God. And so my question to you, are there any things that take preeminence in your life other than the Lord? Is all that you do subject to the Lord's discretion, or are you acting on your own? Are you building faith in your life? Whose voice are you listening to, the voice of man or the voice of God? Who do you fear, God or man? We need to be able to answer these questions in our heart. And then I read with you what Peter said. And I took you down and I started to read you the Great Commission. That commission doesn't stop just because man doesn't want it to happen. In Mark 16... 17 through 18. It says, and these signs shall follow those who believe. In my name they will cast out demons, they will speak with new tongues, they will take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it will not harm them. And it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. You see, you have to understand, church, is that Satan does not want us to fulfill the Great Commission. Satan doesn't want people free. He knows where he's going. He already knows what his lot in life will be and where his eternity will be. And he wants to take as many people as possible. But you know, when I read scripture, it says that God desires that none should perish. That all should come to repentance and a knowledge of the truth. And God has determined that he wants to work through me. And he wants to work through you to see that fulfilled. Are we ready? Jesus Christ truly is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hebrews 10:39 says, but we are not of those who draw back to perdition, in other words, to destruction, but of those who believe to the saving of the soul. We need to press in. I'll tell you what, it's real easy. I tell people when I have an opportunity to be a part of somebody converting and crossing from death to life and repenting and coming into the kingdom of God, I tell them there is one word out there that you need to become accustomed to. It is a beautiful word. And that word is R-E-P-E-N-T, repent. It's beautiful. God has given us that word. It's a key to the kingdom of God. Because repentance always precedes salvation. There is no salvation. There is no restoration if a man does not repent. 2 Timothy 3, 12 through 15, and we're almost done. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. Wow, that's really nice, isn't it? Why? Because there's more that don't love the Lord than there are that do love the Lord. Jesus came into the world, even though the world was made in and through him, for him, and by him, the world did not receive him. So when you want to stand up and start living in accordance with God's word, people are going to oppose you. But we need to have the resolve that, you know what? Lord, I'm going to do what you want me to do. Some of those people will be close family and friends. Some of those people will be your neighbors that won't even want to look at you. But you know what? You just smile at them and you keep your heart right in Christ. It says, but evil men and imposters will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But you must continue in the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them. And that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. You see, the Lord doesn't want us living as fools. He wants us to walk as wise because we are his ambassadors. You know, when I pray over myself, I pray over my wife, my kids, I pray over our board, I pray over the leaders of this church, I pray, Lord, lead them and guide them for your name's sake. Don't let them go out and do things that are stupid and embarrassing and puts a bad mark on you. Lead them. But you can't do that if you aren't paying attention. Then if you don't take heed, be sober and be vigilant. Matthew 24, 9 through 15 says, then they will deliver you up to tribulation. We're back in Matthew. And kill you. Boy, he was speaking the truth to him right there, wasn't it? Because all but one of the apostles were killed. James was killed by the sword. Peter was crucified upside down. Paul was beheaded. And you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will be offended. Boy, isn't that what's happening now? I mean, I cannot believe some of the emails that they got here from Christians. Shame on you. They hate us. They hate the pastor. They hate the board. They hate, and you know what? The board gave in to that. They let the pressure of the people influence their decision. And that's sad. I remember waking up that morning, it was March 16th, and I woke up. And when I woke up in the morning, I read the paper, I saw some stuff in the paper, and I learned that, well, the churches were all closing down. And I went, wow, I've never seen that before in my life. All the bars are still open. All the liquor stores are still open. All the pot dispensaries are still open, but the churches have closed. That is messed up. That is not right. And we cannot let that happen again. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution, but evil men and imposters will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But you must continue in the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them. And that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you, Matthew 24, 9 through 15. And you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will be offended, will betray one another, and will hate one another. And I'll tell you what, this word hate, I had a conversation with Thomas Vigil. He's on our board of directors. And he was asking me, he said, Tim, how important is forgiveness? And I said, well, I'll tell you what, it's so important that Jesus said, if you don't forgive, my Father in heaven won't forgive you either. Well, now, wait a minute, I believe in Jesus. Yeah, it applies to everyone. You must forgive. You must forgive. Because I'll tell you what, when you don't, and for those of you that sent the nasty emails and all the things to the church, I beg you, I implore you in the name of Jesus to let it go and ask forgiveness from your Heavenly Father and put out an I'm sorry to the church so that you will not be burdened down with the weight of unforgiveness, thereby opening the door up for a root of bitterness to get into your life and thereby defiling many. Because I'll tell you what, sin is deceitful and it will deal with you in a harsh way. And like I said, there's a beautiful word out there, and that word is repent. So I encourage you, repent and get right in your heart with God. It says that then many will be offended, will betray one another, will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because of lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. But he, and here's the deal, regardless of what's going on around us, when our eyes are intently focused upon Jesus, the author and the perfecter, the finisher of our faith, the one who died and rose from the dead, the one who sits next to the right hand of the throne of God, and the one that all authority on heaven and earth has been given to him, the one that will sit on the white throne of judgment at the end of time. But he who endures to the end shall be saved. Amen? We need to endure. We need to push through. So what if you make a mistake? You make a mistake, get over it. Move on. Too many people live in the grief of their mistake and they let the mistake control their lives instead of just being honest, going to a brother and confess your faults, going to God and admit your faults and letting Jesus cleanse you of all unrighteousness. Sounds simple, doesn't it? It only gets complicated when our soul is not in the right place. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come. And I want to tell you something, people. I believe that we are very, 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 very close to the gospel being preached to every kingdom throughout the world. There's not many things that are left that need to be done. I don't know what the days or the numbers of the Gentiles are. I don't know if that's the number of people coming to the Lord or if it's a time allotted by God. But I just see all the signs. The signs say, don't play with your salvation. It's not a dice you throw against the wall, and it's not a gun that you spin the chamber and see if you get shot. Get it right with God. Get your life on track, because he wants above all things to be with you. And if you aren't with him, it's not his choice, it's your choice. Matthew 12, 27 says, now this, yet once more, indicates the removal of those things that are being shaken, as of things that are made, that the things which cannot be shaken may remain. Why did we just go through this test? Why is there the beginning of sorrows? Because God is shaking things up, and so that he can see that that which is not of him will not remain, and only that which is of him shall remain. That's why we need to get it right. That's why we need to pursue. And I'm not saying that I have attained it all, but I'll tell you what, I am not a perfect man, but I am a man that pursues perfection, and that perfection is only found in a personal, intimate, close relationship with Jesus Christ. It's been 30 years since I was run over by a train. 30 years. I'm 62, I'll be 63 next month. But I remember that when you go through something like this, and Tim probably can relate to this a little bit, they put you through physical therapy, occupational therapy, and psychological therapy. I cruised right through the physical therapy. I already knew at the settlement that I was going to be fine, so that took care of the occupational therapy. But I went through psychological therapy, and in my session of sitting down with the psychiatrist, he sat on the other side of his desk, leaning back with his legs crossed, and as I tried to explain my faith to him, he just kept saying, "You're in denial. You're in denial. Tim, you're in denial." You know, like I couldn't look down and see, okay, there really is only one leg, one foot, and there really is only one hand right now. And he just wouldn't listen to me. Why? Because salvation is foolishness to those who are perishing. And finally, I got to the point where I just knew the conversation was coming to an end, and the Holy Spirit rose up inside of me. And he said that to me one more time. And I rose up, I stood up, and I leaned over his desk, and I put my hand on his desk like this. And I got as close as I could get to his face. And I said, "You're right. I'm in denial. I deny that this will ruin my life. My life will be reigned and ruled by Jesus Christ and Him alone." And I went, boom, on his desk. And he about fell out of his chair. And I sat back down. Whoops, excuse me. And as I sat down, he grabbed his book and he closed it. And he said, "Well, I do believe we're done here." And I looked at him and I said, "Yes, I do believe we're done here." And I went on. You see, people, that was a rising of the Holy Spirit in me. It was a Jesus moment. It was a revelation of the power of God in Tim Scott, that I am not going to let anything keep me from my Savior and my King. Doesn't matter whether I have bad habits or whatever it is, it will all submit to the living King, because I desire above all things the same thing He desires, and that is to be free. And people, we need to have that same resolve, all of us. We need to look at those bad habits of our life. I don't care what it is. I don't care what you call it by. I don't care if it's smoking or drinking or drugs or pornography or lust or covetousness or whatever it is. You need to look at it and you need to say, "No, you will not rule my life. My life will be reigned and ruled by Jesus Christ and Him alone, period. So that we may move forward and God may be glorified." Because it says in James, in 4:8, and we'll be closing with this, "Draw near to God, and He will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded." This is but the beginning of sorrows, people. There is more to come. And we have a responsibility to prepare our hearts and lives before the Lord. In Christ, we can do all things. Apart from Him, we will fail. We'll make Him look bad. It will greatly impact the kingdom of God for a very long time. So I say to you, ready your hearts, for the King is coming. And Jesus would say to you, "Do you not see all these things? Open your eyes and know that very soon your redemption draweth nigh." I'll tell you what, when the trumpet sounds, I don't want to run for the mountains and hide. I want to lift my hands and say, "Lord, here am I." I hope you want to do the same. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the privilege of being able to be here today. I know some things are hard to swallow, much like they said of the things that Paul said, a little hard to understand. But Lord, I know that your grace is present. I know there is no time or distance or space that you cannot occupy. So I thank you, Lord, for occupying the hearts of everyone that heard this message. And I pray, Lord, from this day forward that those that heard this message will receive this message, and that they, oh Lord, will be changed for the rest of their lives. That no longer will they be weak and spineless, but they shall be courageous and gentle. That they will seek ye first the kingdom of God and your righteousness. That they will, through the power of God and the wisdom of God and the leading of the Holy Spirit, prioritize their life in the right way. And husbands, love their wives. Pray for their wives.
As you cover us in your word, I pray that the husbands would cover their wives in the word of God, that they would wash them to present them clean unto you, that the husbands would fulfill their responsibilities before you, Lord, and that wives would respect their husbands, that they would submit to their husbands as to the Lord, not being argumentative and contentious, that they each would be kind and tenderhearted one to another, forgiving one another as God in Christ has forgiven them. That from this day forward in their homes, there will be the peace of Christ that surpasses all understanding. That there will be a unity between them. That even their family and their friends will go, wow, you look different, you act different, you sound different. That the TVs would be shut off, the game systems would end. And that people would put their noses in the Word of God and bend their knees to the authority of Christ. I look forward, as Pastor Tim said, to the coming together of the church. And Lord, I may not agree with some of the leaders that took it that way, but I pray for them, Lord. I pray for the grace of God to be in abundance in their hearts. I pray that they have courage and strength to endure. Lord, we can sure talk a big talk. I pray, Lord, that we start walking the right walk so that people can see that if we say we really believe that God is with us and that we do not fear the pestilence by day nor the terror by night, that they see a courage and the strength of the body of Christ and in believers, that even in the midst of COVID-19, it will not come nigh our dwellings because our God is for us. It is the blood of Jesus that coats us, that marks us, protects us. And it is the blood we pray over our families, our churches, our leaders, and our homes. And that blood, as it was in the Passover, it protects. And your blood is incredible, Lord. I pray for our government leaders. I pray for Mayor Windermere. I pray for the Post Falls Dalton. And I pray also for the Hayden Mayor. I pray for our government and all our representatives, Father. I pray for those that know you will take it serious and understand that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And those that don't, I pray, Lord, they would come to know you. Surround them, Lord, with your grace. Let your mercy trump all judgment. Where would we be without it? We'd be lost. We'd be discouraged without hope. Because that's what we were, Lord, before we came to you. We were lost in the world without hope. But now, according to Peter, we now live in accordance with a living hope that doesn't fade with time. It's not impacted by circumstances. It's not weakened by men. And it's not weakened by time, because you are eternal. You are eternal, Lord. You are. So prepare our hearts, Lord. Prepare our hearts. Grant us by your grace to be your people. And allow us, Lord, to purify our souls by obeying the truth. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. And all that out there agreed with that prayer said, amen. Thank you.
Get out of your way here, real quick. Oh, okay. I'll just stay right there.
Praise the Lord. At the very end, at 1 o'clock this afternoon, we're going to have a little freedom march. It's going to be at Independence Point. All the church is invited to go down there. This is just to let the community know that we would like to open, let our leadership know that we would like to open. And so, Independence Point, 1 o'clock, if you would like to be there. God bless you. I hope to see you all there.
God bless. Love you, man.